Now we are at a critical junction in this build, and on the last DVD I confirmed that my weights were within the parameters I wanted. And the next step on this, and I decided, well, I decided early on in this build that I would put an all-out effort into the finish and make this the best I possibly could. And this last coat of silver, I'm sure most people would be, you know, well, maybe they'd love it. I don't know. But I decided I'm going to push this just a little bit further. And I'm going to take this last coat of silver, and because the weather's been so miserable, rather than sanding it out with 600, which would be the normal way to do this, I'm going to sand it out with 1,000. I have some 1,000 grit paper, and I'm going to really make an effort in the next day or so to get this whole thing ready for what I think will be my final decanted coat of silver. Now, that means that I'm going to have to be very careful with this, not to go through unnecessarily, because if I do, of course, there's going to be a touch-up. And I'd really like this to be the final coat of silver. Now, sanding with 1,000 grit takes a lot longer than 600. So my first thought is I'm going to be willing to spend a lot more time. This is going to take, well, if the 600 took 2 hours, 4 hours, this will take more, 5, 6, 8, who knows. But the point is, the weather has been so bad around here that I don't even care. And number two, since we've finally closed and done with our rental property issues, it's freed me up for a couple extra hours of modeling virtually every day. So I want to combine these two factors into making this finish as good as I can, almost like going to a car dealer and saying, I want the best car possible. I don't care what it costs. Here's my checkbook. Put the amount in. And a lot of times when we've finished models in the past, we've not had that option. We've been under the gun with rental property issues and just a myriad of things. Well, now we're not. And now we really are going to try to up the bar here a little bit. And there's the reason, because I wanted this to be a very special plane to honor his eminence. We've referred to him as Lord Baltimore in the 5.5 years we spent pretty much together the whole day. And another thing, because this plane is going to pretty much be yellow, white, and black, these colors are going to be, wherever it's black, it's going to be very easy to find any flaw. And the yellow, if I don't do a good job and I have to spray extra yellow on everything, it's going to be a real problem. It's going to be, well, that we're going to add weight unnecessarily, and I really want the plane not only to come out looking nice, but right at my goal weight. Now, in the events of the last, well, week or so, that as they've gone by, we've tried to get these parts what I thought they were, as good as it gets. But again, I have a special motivation here. And even though, again, even though these parts look, well, they look pretty good, in fact. But I know in the past, several times I've taken the extra step of, before the last coat, sanding everything out with 1,200. Well, not, I don't have any 1,200. There's the reason. But I do have a sleeve of 1,000. And this is going to take a lot more time. But I'm going to be very, very meticulous about sanding this out. The other thing is, this final coat, I'm going to take one of those cans that's been on the shelf for a year, decant it, 60% thinner, make sure that I've got exactly the ratio I want, do a couple little test pieces, because this last coat of silver, I want this to be razor thin, because a lot of parts of this model, where we're going to have striping, I'm going to have to paint that area white. So that's going to be kind of extra paint, but it's something you have to live with the paint job that I'm anticipating putting on here. I'm still doing concept sketches every night. After dinner, Karen watches her shows, and I sit here sketching. So it's all coming down to the nitty-gritty in the next week or so, and we're going to start once this coat is sanded out. And there isn't a lot of point in, you know, making a big deal out of this, but I just wanted to show, well, we'll just show one part here. Because 1,000 does take a little more effort to get it the way I want it. In other words, with 600, the issue is, right now, this is going to just take, I think, and impart a really nice surface that the tape will stick to.
Again, if this surface is glass smooth, the tape lays down perfectly. If it's got microscopic little glitches in it, you get that stuff where things run under the edges of the tape. And especially on the wing, where most of the trim on this plane, including the lettering, which will be a labor of love if it's anything like the other ones, but we're trying to keep all the doors open. I still haven't really figured out, and I told Rich Walbridge this one day, I said, I never figure out what color I'm going to... This is the first plane I know what color it's going to be, basically, because I want it to be the color of the bird. I almost never know the color of the plane, right up until the last week or so, a couple days even. I mean, there's been planes that I've thought for the whole build of the plane, I thought I'd make it yellow. And the day I go to paint it, I see a Kenworth truck go by or something, then all of a sudden I change my mind. Or I find, and I was hoping... That I get a vision in a dream or something. Well, that didn't happen, but I really am excited about the quality of the finish. Now, that little spot that I painted, you can, believe me when I tell you, you can actually look at this with the light reflecting. You can see light reflecting when you sand with 1,000. Now, that's gonna mean the tape is really gonna lay down nice and really be, and I don't care how long this takes. If it takes 2 or 3 days, I don't care. If I get it done tonight, I don't care. I just want the best I can possibly make this. I've made, and it's my own personal commitment. I don't look at this like, well, nobody will ever see that, and a Banjock won't see this, and somebody won't see that. I look at it's my own personal challenge, and the person I need to satisfy is myself. I really need to go to bed at night knowing that I've done the best I can, and that's what really motivates me here. To go this is going to add an extra few days to the build, means nothing. It's like, I want it, and that day that we bring it out to the flying field for the first time and Joe Adamusco stops by, I want it to be as good as it can be. Now, I haven't looked at the email yet today, but yesterday Joe told me he was going to be sending me some pictures of a Spitfire up, and I think he's pretty much ready to fly it, but needless to say, with the weather the way it's been, you couldn't fly a fly swatter out there today. It's been awful, but that's what I wanted to show is when this is all sanded, I want to see that gloss on it where I can candle it and just see, I probably could see my hand as a reflection. And then I know that last coat of silver that's decanted and has that extra pigment is going to lay down. It'll look like it's carved from a billet of aluminum, like a Rojet motor. Now, I never try to tell people that the way I finish models is the only way to finish them. There's a lot of extra different ways to do it, and I wouldn't pretend even for 1 second that this is the only way that works. But this is the way I can pass on to you, and hopefully, as I've done with many other people, like Dave Midgley and among others, that they've been able to pass it on to other people. And this whole idea of committing yourself early on in a build to excellence is it's a unique concept for some people. A lot of people are caught up in being very expedient and with nobody will see that, and I don't know. You know, there's all these different arguments that, or why would you spend all that time when you could be doing something interesting like watching Dancing with the Stars? Well, for me, this is the interesting thing. This is the thing I strive for. It's the passion I live for, you know, as well as my model railroad, my motorcycles, and of course, Karen and my family. When I get up in the morning, I got a lot of things to live for, a lot of friends checking in with me every other day or so, and a lot of cool stuff happening. And I granted, I miss a lot of Oprah shows. I miss a lot of the things that a lot of people live for, the three dwarfs and a man, or three men and a child, or whatever that friends we go out to dinner with, they ask us, did you see this show? Did you see that show? And Karen and I are lost. We haven't seen any of them. Because she's usually doing a lot, she does a lot of reading. I do a lot of sanding. And I'm telling you, in the end, I'm pretty sure we won. I just can't picture where your life goes when you sit in front of the tube too long. But if that's what turns you on, great. Well, I just want to show one piece here, and that hole, I can see my hand in it. Now, this is the base. This is what we're going to be building our finish on. It's the base. And if you see that finish and you've sanded with 1,000 grit, you are ready to do the finish of your life. And if that's the only thing you can pick up off the DVD, this whole set of DVDs is well worth it. Because that's the secret right there. The fact that it's light and the fact that everything that lays on here is going to lay flat now. It's not going to be crooked and twisted and... Now, interesting little story, and I wanted to share this before we get done here. We're not going to put too much of the sanding silver on because, I'm even bored with it. This is the kind of stuff that happens to Karen and I, and you never could make this up even if you wanted to. Karen, about a week or 10 days ago, she had an unfortunate accident. She slipped on the ice and where the girls in the neighborhood get together and play Mahjong. And it was raining and snowing, and I asked her, do you need me to walk you over there? And she said, no, I'll do it myself. And she slipped on the ice, fell down a porch, hurt her back. Now, because of that, the woman where they, and these people only live three houses down the road, but we weren't really close friends with her husband. Her husband, I had only met at our block party. So last night he stopped over the house and he was, you know, asking us if he'd like to pay the doctor bills or whatever, and we don't need that. We have our own insurance. But what was great, I found out all his life, even when he was a boy, he had control line models. He's got a cellar full of Aries, Shark, old K&B motors. And what it is, his children prefer rockets now. They have model rocket, and he's been involved in this rocket club, and he invited us to go up to the rocket club. And they launch rockets. And I said, you know what would even be cooler? I'll take your kids, or you come with them, and come down one day when we're having one of our meets with the control line. Well, he still knows how to fly control line. And when I showed him our cellar, he had a tear in his eye. He says, I didn't even know this was so popular anymore. And oh my God, look at these. He went crazy. Well, you know what? That's what I like about what we do. You have a small group, but it's a passionate group, and they never forget. Now, you could be the same person and go bowling when you were a kid, but later on in life, somebody says bowling, it doesn't stir a passion. Well, I don't know, but I think in the very near future, his name is Don. And we call him the Duck, and the reason is because they used to call him Donald Duck as a kid, but he's got an Aries and a Shark, and I'm dying to go see it. And he rides motorcycles.
So it's basically a small world. I'm going to sand the rest of this off camera, to be honest. I think I can do it either in this session or come back down after supper and finish it up. I want to finish it up because the next paintable day, and we don't have a paintable day today. We haven't had a real paintable day in a long time. I want to have it all ready, sitting up by the heating vent with the paint in the gun ready to go for the next paintable day. That's my goal. Boy, I just had, as I'm in the middle of sanding out here, I had a great call from Ian Smith in Australia, who's started building a Joe Adamusco, Windy, let's give Adamusco the credit, a Spitfire. He's on board, he wants canopies, all of the little accoutrements, and we're gonna try to help him out, of course, every step of the way. And so the good news is when we visit Australia, which we hope is gonna be in my lifetime, of course, we may get to see or fly Ian Smith's, and I know he's just hot to trot. He has been spit-fired up, inspired, I guess inspired like I am, just to... join the RAF. Congratulations, Ian. Well, like all of the parts, and I haven't done the fuse or the wing yet, this needed a lot of working by the fillets, and I didn't want to compromise anything, but I got all of the flaps, all of the elevators, and it's coming up on the end of the day when I got to do some email. Got that all sanded out, and there are definitely still some spots that come right up, as well as on the tail after sanding them out. But you know what, I don't want to rush this. I'm going to have pretty much a full day tomorrow in the shop, and I'll leave the fuse, even if it takes two extra days. I want to get them really detailed out to where actually they have, these actually have a little bit of a shine to them. You can actually see the reflection in it of the handle of the doorknob. Well, and when that gets its really thin coat of silver on it, I think that's going to just add one notch up in the bar for the finish on this.
Now, in today's email, we got some pictures of Joe Adamusco's finished 90 Spitfire. And I'm sure, with the weather the way it is, he's not itching to fly it today, but boy, it looks outstanding in the pictures. And we'll be test flying this as soon as the weather breaks. I'm sure he's itching. Now, I know the color doesn't show up that well in these pictures. It kind of washes away, but it's the color Karen likes, that color blue that the camera planes were. Boy, that really looks nice. And I know Joe's got a super detailed cockpit pilot. He may even be able to talk Joe into coming up here with the model so we could do a little bench trimming on it. And that may be coming. I'm gonna email Joe back about a bench trim day. And we can sit here and, I'm telling you, get a photo shoot with my Spitfire too. Anyway, congratulations to Joe Adamusco. That is, I know, that's one special effort.
And his twin is over there saying, bring him up here so we can do a photo shoot.
I agree. No, when we got up this morning, oh my God, another morning of the pipes are almost frozen. Oh my God, this is terrible. See what, I'm almost glad, look, I'm almost glad I didn't finish that painting because I'd be tempted to, the sanding, I'd be tempted to run out there and get some painting. And when it's this cold, you can't even hold a spray gun in your hand, it's terrible. But we'll have a nice leisurely day to do some other things in the shop.
And it's funny, the weather has controlled the pace of this build. It's crazy.
But the good news is the birds are back at the feeder. They're cold, we're cold. Time to get that Gervalia going and get down to the shop. It is really brutal out there. I went to get the newspaper. In 30 seconds, you got to chill right to the bone.
Now, while I'm reading the paper this morning, you know what was very interesting, we went over to the motorcycle show and we got to see the spot, exact spot. We actually were right at the spot where this is the plane that landed in the Hudson River, and it came through town yesterday. It's actually on the front page of our local paper. It came through town and we didn't even get to see it. I can't believe that. But anyway, boy, that's been the miracle of the winter here.
Now, what happened the other night, and I just wanted to mention this because I think this is pretty interesting. We met one of our neighbors again through Karen falling on his porch, and we got, in the course of the conversation, he's got a bunch of old control line planes and he builds rockets, and I've already gone over that. But one of the things he does, he's a contractor, and he came up with a couple of ideas for my garage, for renovating my garage, because one of the things I wanted to make out there is a spray booth with heat. And let me get the phone. I haven't even had my coffee yet. Let me get the phone. This is really not that funny. I have this little electric heater that when push really comes to shove, I sit by the heater. And this morning it's so damn cold. I'm sitting here and I can't warm up even after having my coffee. But anyway, the idea was that maybe by this time next winter I would have a garage with a spray booth with heat. That was the whole idea. And he has done those kind of things, and he's gonna be helping us draw up a plan for the next season. At which time also we were thinking we'd do one thing is renovate this shop and the garage at the same time. Anyway, the next step on this, and I'm not gonna sand the rest of this out till later this afternoon until it warms up a little bit, because my hands just being in the water while I'm sanding is even cold. It's actually very cold in the shop right now. But I wanted to make the little logo that's gonna go on a tail, and I had this box of pictures, and I was looking in here for, I got some down at the bottom. In fact, some of these are the Chicky pictures, among others. We got old Paul Winter's face there. But I wanted to look for something that I'm going to lay out kind of a little logo for the tail. And John Pothier is going to help me, but what I need to do is size it. I need to get the size. And I wanted to kind of incorporate the Keystone logo into it because it matches the tips. And then I wanted to really find what I thought was the best shot we have of Chicky's head, which I'm not sure we have in here. Rainbow Bark made me copies of these pictures. Hey, we got one right here that's good. This one I like. Anyway, I'm going to spend a little time. I'm actually going to sit by the heater here. My best friend, the heater. Boy, I'll tell you, this winter has been unbelievable. And you know what's happened? I've spoken to a couple other people that are my age. I'm 63. And everybody, when they get into their 60s, the first thing is, oh, my feet are always cold. My hands are cold. And Karen and I are both going through the same evolutionary process as our bodies come come to their time for an overhaul. Now, see, these are the original ones we had, but I didn't want to keep using the same shape over and over again. In fact, I even have some that are a little bit bigger here. But I want to come up with a whole new one if I can. And I'm not sure we got all these pictures, and actually this is a heartbreaking picture when Kent was here. But we got enough pictures. We're gonna work on something. And John Pothier is gonna be working on this with us. That's our project for today. The first thing I need to do is get the size right. I need to get, because it's gonna be basically on the rudder. And then I need to make a kind of a rendition of it and then lay it next to a ruler and take a picture and then electronically send it to John so he can see it's so many inches by so many inches by so many inches. So I'm going to have a little bit of time here to play paper dolls right now. And I'm not going far from that heater, believe me. Well, the first thing is I wanted to lay this out. Well, I got to get a piece of tape on this too so that the rudder's not flopping around, because the rudder composes part of the shape that we're looking for. And I wanted to see it not on a flat plane, but how it would look. I want to figure how big of a spot I want to have on that. I wanted to start with something that I know is too big. See, I don't want it coming over the hinge line, but I can trim this back, and of course it hopefully picks up some of the angles, the wingtip angles. But I can massage this as many times as I want. As an example, right now, I'll get all these straight when I make the final pattern. And sometimes just by taking the slightest bit off, now see, it still looks too wide. That's still wide. So I need to take, if I do this methodically, I just take an eighth of an inch off each side. I'll come up on, sneak up on the area that I want to have. Move this up. Now this is kind of a representation of the keystone that you would use on, several things, a Pennsylvania Railroad for one. Still looks too big. So, again, this gets where it's in the eye of the beholder here, but if we take an eighth of an inch at a time, I think at some point in time, let's see something. It's still too wide, I think. So let's take an eighth of an inch off this side. Very scientific, by the way. And of course, in the worst of all worlds, I'll just go get one of my railroad books and dig out something that has the Pennsylvania. But I don't want it to be a copy, I want it to be a mimic. Now I still think it's big because I'm going to have to outline this with eighth inch tape. No, it's going to be a decal, so I don't need to account for the outline. Now I thought maybe I'd try this. And this is the way, I'm just trying to show what my thought process is on designing stuff like this. And now the top got too small looking. That looks better. That looks pretty close to what I want. Yeah, I think that's going to be good. Well, now what I got to do with this, I need to come up with a black outline and a white outline, and then I need to figure out what's going to be in here. Well, I need to have these logos in black background and white background, because I don't know what color ultimately I'll want to paint the rudder, or if I'll want to change it right in the middle of everything, which I'm very prone to do. My great artistic eye checks something out and I say, oh, like it better black. So while he's laying these out, and it's not a big deal, I don't think, anyway, to run it with several different background colors. So we'll have the choice of making the background black or the background white. But that's pretty much the size we want. If this were black, okay, now John has the graphics for this, so what I'm going to do is lay out a sheet, put all the dimensions on this, and then take a picture of it and send it to him electronically. And I think then he can come up with the logo and the little things in there. And then we can shrink these down and make little things for the prop or several other different sizes. So now all I'm going to do with this is take a photo of this, and then from that photo send it electronically, and by next couple days John can lay out the bird, and we want to have the words "never forgotten" under there. But that's the general shape.
Now it's just a question of, I'll take two or three pictures so I can get this as detailed as I can. Usually I can take one with the light out, sometimes that's better.
Now it's just a question of downloading these, and in 10 minutes they'll be in Anaheim, in Redlands, California. And we'll see what comes back when John gets a chance to work on it. I'm kind of glad we waited till today to, because I sure don't want to rush. The parts are nice and warm from being a bite of heat up there. But what I wanted to do here, of course, I'm going to try to get either the fuselage or the fuselage and the wing sanded out. Depends on how many phone calls we have today, how many ancillary things we have to deal with. But the biggest thing, and I had forgotten about this, Karen just reminded me that tomorrow they're going to start the project of digging up the backyard, and I'm going to have to be out there because there's several things around the pond, especially we don't want them to touch, and I've got to kind of be, supervisor or something. But I'm sure they're going to figure out some way of making me freeze the whole day. I can't believe they're going to dig the yard up when the ground is frozen, but, well, we'll see. And they said if the weather's good. Now, I don't know what that means either. But I wanted to show. Here's a couple of little, now see the little tiny dry spot up around the needle valve? Yeah, you could paint over that. But you know what? I really want this to be perfect. And I could paint over that for sure. There's a couple little other areas. See up around the cockpit here? There's one little spot. This side looks pretty good. Now, what I found out is, number one, this sanding this out with 1,000 sandpaper takes a lot longer than with 600, of course. In here, you're not going to see it because of the pipe tunnel, but and the fillets, you can see there's a small little bubble bed down there that we'll take care of those. In fact, it's probably the best thing here to take care of those little bubbles on the fillets before I start sanding anything and getting it wet. In fact, I'll do that one first. Now, it seems like if you have one of the little tips or tricks that could be used, one of the things that works for me is, and these are a couple of mistakes I made along the way that I made them the hard way. I had a razor blade, I was doing something, I left the razor blade under here. And as I'd be pressing down, I got up and the shape of the razor blade was in the back. So what I try to do before I start every session is just run my hand over here. And I keep putting new towels and new bedspreads and things, but it doesn't take long and they get dirty. But if you can fix these, and I wonder if I can get in here with, let me just see if I can show this. Oh yeah, that's a soft bubble.
Because this is the thing that makes people crazy, is when they have, and especially if you have big fillets. If you're a guy that likes big fillets, oh man, that can make you crazy. And the trick is to always use a brand new blade, not something that's dull. You want to put razor cuts in there. Now because, let me just get this off here. See, I have hinges out here of all stupid things for working on that other part. And the only way you really learn these lessons is by slamming your hand in a car door. And my hands are all beat up from doing just that. So, let me show this up close because this is important.
See how down I can get the lens. See how I filled that full of holes? Now it doesn't mean, and I've done this on camera of course, it doesn't mean that's going to be the final time. This might be the last coat of clear and I have to do that. But what I do is, even if it's the last coat of clear, I can do that, put a little touch up, put some more clear in there, right to the end. Because once that starts peeling up, if you were to let that go, the next time you soften it, this moves up, and pretty soon you have a bubble. The trick is to nail these. This side doesn't look so bad. But if I could just get some of these little things on camera, these are the little things that to me make that the plane is awesome, not just nice, it's awesome.
I'm twisting the Q-tip as I go. I'm not just rubbing it, I'm twisting it. And then now that's soft now. It's not dry yet, it's soft. I'd take a piece of 1000 grit if I was sanding with 600, I'd take 600. Fold it four times so you have a thickness of four. Now it's like an edging tool. And just get in there. And all that does is press it down. I'm not looking to sand it. I'm looking to press it down. And I can remember, and this is really, really one of the memories I remember vividly. Many really beautiful planes that were superbly finished, beautiful in every way, and had a big bubble in the fillet. And it just could make you crazy. Like owning a new Ducati with a chunk of paint missing out of the fuel tank. So it might be a good tip that before you even get any water near these bubbles, repair anything that looks like a little bubble. Because this is, I hope, the last coat. I hope. See, I've been hoping for a long time, but it, little by little, and sometimes you have to do it four, five, six times, that side looks better, but in the back, let me show that. These are the little things right in the back here. You can see there's a little bad spot, and yeah, I am fanatical about it. Because once it's right, it's right. Now this feels like a harder spot than the other. Nah, it's soft up here. It's hard in the back. It's probably got some CA in there, but it isn't sticking the way it should. A little dry spot there too. It doesn't take much CA to leak its way in there. And I find that when it's done right, and you look down there and the light goes right down that fillet, it's a thing of beauty. It's amazing how, when it's cold like this, I'm kind of glad I have this day to do the sanding, because boy, I wouldn't want to be outside today. When it's 30 degrees, you can be out there. When it's 20, and when it's below 20, it's just murder. I've tried to paint and my hand sticks to the gun. And that's why I'm thinking seriously about trying to make a spray booth if financially we can swing it after we're done with this landscaping job. And I have this neighbor now that I know does this stuff for a living. Maybe I get him to design me something really cool. And he rides motorcycles, so. Former Control Line flyer. Maybe I can get him to subscribe to Control Line World. We'll see.
Now I cut up some more 1000 and I made sure I didn't commingle it with the 600 because I want this to be, from this point on, nothing but 1000 touching this. And I think that truly is overkill, but I'm willing to spend the time right now. Every time I think about it, I think, yeah, in the olden days, I wouldn't have been this ambitious, but this is the one plane that I would be willing to spend this extra time on, because it's a very special project to me, and it's kind of like that motorcycle of mine that I'm not sure what the attraction is, but the more I work on it, the more I like it, and the more I'm enjoying the memories of, I think the reality is it just makes me feel young again. I daydream about some days, I guess they were the days before 9/11, where you don't even realize how the whole world changed, and all of a sudden one day it's like it is now, and everybody's suing everybody, and you got building inspectors breathing down your nose every time you want to burp, and I don't know, just something about the day that I really can see why people are attracted to restoring old cars and old airplanes, because it reminds them of a simpler time. Now, this is what I wanted to show, too, is I really don't want to go through any more than I have to, because I know I have a real razor coat. Let's see if I can see the shine on there. Yeah, almost. I don't want to go down through. I don't want to have to go back and touch this up 6, 7, 8 times. I want to have this as nice, as absolutely as I possibly can. Now, that little spot up there. See, the fussier you get, the more you see little spots. Doesn't matter. When I'm done with that fuselage, I don't care if that's the only thing I get done today. I want that to be that every single part of it, every little flaw is taken care of. And then you hope none of the wild hogs get up here and they help you pick your plane up. And they put their vice grip hands on it or something. Maybe we'll have to really baby this guy or something. I don't know. Now, as it always is, the hardest part of this sand out is, and this tool is just invaluable. From this whole project, this is the best tool that's come out of this. And what I've tried to figure a way of doing, I've even trimmed this back even more so that I could get in there. Because otherwise, if you look in that scoop and it looks like, like a rat's nest, you lose some of the effect of the scoop, which is one of the defining features of, the last 3 or 4 of these models. I spoke to Midgley, and Midgley said in a couple weeks he's going to break away from his business, come down here, and they're going to work on Dave Iskin's plane. Dave is coming right along with his, so he's got one of these pretty much, I think I'm a little bit ahead of him, but it doesn't really matter. Now, as with all 1,000 sand outs, this took a lot longer than I thought. And I'm really getting, really happy as can be that I spent the time, believe me. It's funny how in the beginning of one of these things, you think, oh, I'm going to spend another 8 hours or 6 hours or something. And you get all annoyed that you're spending that much time, and you're thinking nobody will ever see that. And when it's done, you think, oh, I got it. Anyway, that is ready, as far as I'm concerned. That is ready for the final coat of silver decanted. And it's so cold out there, there's no way I would have sprayed it today, even if it was ready. So I really didn't lose a thing. It really was, it's just the way it is. I know if I lived in Florida, I'd be complaining about the humidity. If I lived by Rich, I'd be complaining. Rich Oliver, I'd be complaining about the... something, the heat, the humidity. Now the last piece is the wing. I'm not even sure if we're going to finish it today, but there's a bubble back there, a little bubble. We'll definitely do that and take care of that. And even if it takes an extra day, that's the good thing about when it's freezing cold like this. I remember that young man from Sweden at the World Championships. I ought to find that video, because that was funny. I said, gee, that's... The detail he had on everything was superb. And I said, how do you have the patience to do that? He says, long winters. And I think that's the key to that. And in speaking of Ramo and becoming a little more familiar with the Swedish culture, they do have some long winters up there. and being real honest, but years ago it used to frustrate me. Nothing frustrated me more than these crazy little bubbles and fillets. And now Rich Walbridge had a little bit of an issue on his Spitfire around the canopy, and I think the problem was that he didn't scuff it up enough. You never can scuff it up too much. You can always fill it in with paint. Paint bonds to a tooth. Yeah, it looks about as good as we're going to get that. Not sure, but when you poke in the tip of an 11 blade and you see it's a bubble or it's soft, you know you got to do something. Now, when it's this small, here's another trick. I wanted to show this in close-up. Put the CA, don't drip any on the blanket, and then just rub the CA in rather than... Take another Q-tip. I think that's the biggest single thing people have that are trying to really make things nice. And one thing can be really frustrating is when these little bubbles appear. Now we had one up here too. I think we had a couple little ones, but you know what? As long as you're willing to just spend the time to go after these little guys. And it won't really matter. We are determined to get these. Anything. Get a piece of that sandpaper. Boy, if there's nothing else to get off the video, getting this little tip worth its weight in gold. And I try to sand it from this side and from this side, so I grill that edge back. Now that sandpaper's folded, I can fold it back the opposite way. Just keep moving that groove so I have a nice cutting edge. Yeah, there's never a time when I'm satisfied. Right up until the last coat of clear, I'm looking to see if they are sticking down or if there's any tendency to pull up. And there's no magic trick. Just like a bad stepchild, you just got to keep beating it down. Now the final thing, and I'm not sure I'm going to finish this today. I want to get this all sanded out with 1000. Get all that sanded out. And then we're going to have a test of willpower to see if that weather's going to warm up. They said it may warm up this weekend. I don't believe for 1 minute it's going to warm up this weekend. But this is going to be pretty redundant, just the normal sand out that goes with the tip weight box, of course. I want to make sure that whole thing is as good as I can make it before we even start any spraying. Now, as we come up to the end of this, and I didn't know if I'd be able to get this done today, but it's been kind of a productive day. I got the fuse and this all ready to go, except I'm not even going to consider going out there to paint. The weather report is tomorrow. It should warm up 10 degrees or so. It'll make it a lot more bearable. And to be honest, I am whipped. This really is a big job. And another thing with the 1000 grit paper, I used a half a sleeve of paper. I just see if you can see the shine on this. It's actually looking... I'm not sure some people don't have that amount of shine on a plane after they buff it out. Let's see. You can see my handsome face in there. Forget it. But anyway, I'm going to wipe these down with M600 carefully. Get them all set to go, and I have... The little bit of time I have left here, I want to start, I'm going to work on my concept sketches. And let me explain, the next step on this is going to be a pretty complicated thing, and I've got to make the commitment within the next day or so. But now that all our parts are sanded, we're going to wait. I mean, normally, if we were under some kind of rush or something, if we were being paid by the hour, yeah, you could go out there and paint today. But and at the end of the day, my hands would be so cold, sometimes they don't even warm up when I put them in hot water. Now, the trick with always sanding with 1,000 grit, as soon as you see you're going through, as soon as you see, you're done. At that point in time, you've gotten all of the extra paint off. Now, I had a little imperfection on a trailing edge I worked on. This is what, in a perfect world, the whole plane would look like this, like a mottled, just the thinnest coat, because we're only going to put the absolute minimum of silver on this. We're not going to put on a big, wet, thick coat, a big, windy coat. I had an area here. Now, this, Rich Walbridge will laugh when he says this. I know he dropped a CA on an open bay on his Spitfire, and I was trying to come up with some way to get it off. And I looked, and what had happened is I dropped some CA on here. I was working somewhere here, and I looked at it, and I tried to wipe it off. Well, what happened? I just sanded it and sanded it. But the problem is you can't do that on an open bay. Just one more reason we love these Midgley wings. It was a lot of years in the development, but I really think these are special things. These are like the Ducatis of wings. Anyway, this is what I got to clean all this schmutz off of here. I'm looking again for any spots, anything that might keep this from being the best job I can possibly make.
Now, from this point in the job on, we have a couple of new criteria. Number one, we don't want to get any fingerprints unnecessarily. And I'm trying to flip these towels, and these are all going in the wash. I'm trying to keep this as neat and clean as possible, because from this point on, fingerprints are not going to be our friend. And when I'm spraying decanted material, I really don't want to see a fingerprint. That's one of the criteria I have. I'd like that coat to go on super nice and smooth. Now, the other thing is, because we're going to have what I call a stripe, a barrier stripe. Well, what that means is we're going to have to put, in selected places, we're going to have to put a coat of white. And I need to figure out, at this point in time, back maybe I'll figure it out tonight, exactly where I want to put the white that will become the barrier stripe. Now, I certainly don't want to paint the whole plane white. I want to paint it as close to where that barrier stripe is going to be. So I'm going to kind of, well, I've got to finalize the paint job, and I'm going to have to do that in the next, either tonight or in the next couple of sessions. I want to have all these parts clean and waiting, so if the temperature goes skyrocketing tomorrow up to 30 degrees, I'll be all set to paint. They'll be sitting here waiting to go. I'm going to use the rest of my decanted silver, and at the end of it, it'll probably be a total amount of I'll probably use the rest of the 3 pints that I used on this job. But again, a lot of it got sanded off. We've already used a sleeve of 600 and a half a sleeve of 1,000 on this job, so we've used a lot of sandpaper. But you know what? One of the things I'm not cheap with is sandpaper. I use it and throw it away. I don't try to sand the whole plane out with one little piece, because otherwise I'm just wasting my time, and time, let's face it, time is money. Just ask Bernie Madoff. Anyway, I want all of these parts to be spotlessly clean, and this is just, I'm just going to grind away on them. This is one of the things that just gets, at the end of the day, you kind of, look at the shine on that. Oh, I kind of like that. Now, and at the times I've done this before, I've done that with 1200, and you could see your face in it, but then that last coat of silver, boy, that goes down. It just looks like an aluminum billet when it's nice, when it's done right. And to be honest, it's been a long time coming, but I think the results were within the weight limit, and we certainly have taken care of, I won't say all the flaws, but almost all of them. And even now, as I'm prepping these parts up, I'm thinking, if I find any little mistakes or anything that's jumping out at me, I want to take care of it now. And, you know, in the case of the winter being so cold, I think it's it's almost worked to our favor here in a lot of ways that in winters gone by, when the year of that we developed the Strega ORF, what happened is we were out flying till the middle of January. We were still flying. We never had a winter. And, well, this winter we've had a winter and a winter and a winter. We've had Richard Oliver's winter, Rutherford's winter. We've had everybody's winter. Rainbow Bark's winter. And it's such a long journey doing this, but in the end, when you have that silver part in your hand and it's got that feel, it feels like silk, to me, it's well worth it. So here's the thing we need to figure out now, as far as paint jobs go, and of course, you never know when things could change at the very end. Here's one of the issues. I need to be able to figure out where the white stripe is going to go, and I'm just going to accent this because this will be a white stripe, and I don't know if I'll make this squared off at the tip or what, but basically I need to have that area white. I need to have wherever the striping will be on the fuselage, the whole canopy area, and the whole area where the lettering will be painted white before I start this. Now let me explain how this whole thing started, and I think it's just a good way to do it. Now you can hardly see it on this plane. This is in the early 60s, probably 61 even, but this trim had a white edge on it, and I thought, wow, that's a nice way to do it. And if you look at the sweeper, and this is mid 60s, everything had a white edge. I don't know if you can see it right up by the body. It got a little thicker there, and it had a little point. It was kind of artistic or whatever. I'm not sure that you can even see if that, but there is a white stripe around everything. Now, over the years of the Cardinal, we got into where we had multiple stripes. It was three colors and four colors and five colors, and even around a canopy, multiple colors. Which evolved into all these things that have multiple stripes around everything. Well, but that wore itself out too. And the yellow ones, the green ones, they had, I think, four layers of striping around it. But I always liked the classic look of one stripe. Now, you could always, if you were color coordinating this, you could always color coordinate and just leave those stripes silver. But on the colors we've chosen, the white stands out way more. And just look at the canopy, silver outline, white outline. It pops way more when it's white. So I'm going to pay the price and get these edges of everything in white. And all this multiple striping and all this stuff, it had its place in the 60s and 70s and 80s, but I like the classic look now of the Testarossa look where everything has one edge around it. Now this whole paint job is going to rest on one thing, and I need to assemble a model to figure this out. It's going to be determined on, I want to have a stripe, and after doing all these sketches I realize I've got to break this body up in this dimension. And I'm just going to show this in the roughest way possible. Now, I would like, in an all-perfect world, I would like to have these stripes just kiss the ends of the scoop. And what that does, when you take it to its logical conclusion, what that does, from the pilot's point of view, it makes the body look longer. Now, I'm trying to do several things at once, but the biggest one is I want a paint job that looks good in the air. And I think breaking that body up is going to accent corners. It's going to have a lot of good things. If you do the opposite, and I know this is a fact, if you do the opposite with a fuselage, because I've painted some where the back is a whole different color, it adds another look to it, and it's not the look I'm looking for. I had several little Cardinals, the yellow one, the purple one that we did that way. And this may be good, and it may have its place in modeling, but on this plane, I want the two things I'm striving for is the classic look. I want it to look like a plane from, well, from long ago that has that classic look, like a John DeTavio Falcon, for instance. Well, the thing about older planes, they had very simple paint jobs, and that's one of the things I'm striving for. And one of the other things I wanted was, the whole idea was to paint the leading edge a dark color, so it would for some amount disguise the fact that the wing, when it's flying in heavy wind, it would have a little bit of a disguising thing. And the worst thing is to paint the leading edge a bright color where it jumps out at you. Well, since this plane is going to be yellow and black, that's going to be a no-brainer. Well, we'll figure some way that we'll either bring this back, or we'll, and I don't know until I actually do it, but, or make this, have this little starburst in here. I don't know yet. Or put the little lightning bolt thing in it. Again, until I start laying this out, I don't really know. But I know the requirements so far are, I want a broad stripe on the fuselage somehow, and I want a broad leading edge in a dark color that's not going to show the wing rattling around in the wind. I also want the lettering to be outlined, so I can pretty much tell, and of course the tail has to match. But here's one issue. This is the one issue I have to make a decision on, either now or very soon. If I paint this fuselage, this part dark, okay, and I'm thinking this might be black, and the top and bottom would be yellow, or I could reverse it. This would be black, this would be yellow. I need to tie it into the fuselage and the tail. I don't want to have where the fuselage comes together and a wing is a different color, or I need to factor in a stripe there. That's the last part of this I have to think about. But the first thing to think about is going to be, and I know this is going to happen, the first thing is going to be, well, we don't have the sketch I want, but I know I'm going to have to paint white along this whole area, in this whole area, and then mask it off and make a decision if this is going to be yellow, black, yellow, or black, yellow, black. And I'll make that decision. See, Rich Walbridge thinks that you have to make these decisions ahead of time. Hell, until I pick up the can of paint, I may not make up my decision. But I need to paint that area white, because that's where that stripe is going to be, one single eighth-inch stripe. So I'm just going to lay out a drawing with what I think is the reality of this paint job is going to be that I need to, the whole canopy area has got to be white, because I need to factor in that, I want to be able to bring the stripe back or back. I need to run two stripes down a fuselage, and I'd like them to be one at each end of the scoop, so the scoop would be in a dedicated color. I don't want the stripe going through the scoop. I've laid out some of the paint jobs that have this, where the scoop gets a stripe through it, and it defeats the look I'm looking for. So that was one of the requirements. Now, the other requirement is, and I may have to even, I need to figure out, I want this stripe to be near the high point of the wing, because as the wing faces me, as I'm looking at it, and this is the front of the wing coming at me, I don't want to see anything but a dark color. When it's coming right at me, what I want to see is it's black and it's kind of disappearing. I don't want to see a yellow stripe on top or bottom, so I'm going to figure out where this is ahead of time and measure up from the trailing edge to get some idea. So first of all, so it's a straight line, so that I'm looking at it right from the front, and that whole front, hopefully we can come up with a paint job that makes that disappear, with the black makes it disappear. We'll see. Then we're going to need to lay out our boxes for the lettering. But it pretty much looks like to me that from this point in the wing back, I have to paint this whole thing white. And that looks like, as I lay this out, that's the reality to it. And on the stab and elevator, it pretty much looks like, since I don't know where that stripe's going to be, that I'm going to be, everything that's there. And now what I'll do is I'll kind of figure out ahead of time. So I'll make one final sketch here. And this is just for my reference as I'm laying out the white.
this area will have to be white, because I don't want to paint anything I don't have to. I'm going to have to paint this stripe somewhere in here, and I'm not sure if it's going to go up. In fact, I ought to do this just to be safe. And I know this one, I don't really have to paint the leading edge. I just have to plot where this high spot is. In fact, maybe I can even somehow lay this out. I'm not sure. And then how did I want to? I want to make sure I have the option of bringing this in here. And I want to make sure I have the option of, well, I ought to just make this wide enough, and the option of this. And then I have to paint in here. So that's quite a bit of white. In fact, it's almost like painting the whole wing. So I'll have this sketch when it comes time to actually lay out the white. Now again, the other thing with this white will have to be decanted. I'll start with a new can, I'll decant it, and I don't want to spray it on a freezing cold day because I want to get as thin as possible so that the tape is going to lay down real nice. But that's all stuff for another day. We have really fought the good fight today, and knowing that we're ready to spray that last coat of silver, that as soon as it warms up, that's really going to let me sleep with my head on a pillow tonight. This came on my computer today from Bernie Trent. Like, I think this is really neat. There's some nature pictures, there's some birds, and I think there's 40 of these all together. Don't take yourself so seriously, nobody else does. They're all basically about nature, but really, this is a pretty uplifting thing. Now, he looks nice. He looks like he needs a paint job. Oh, there we go. Look at that. Don't compare your life with others. Nobody's responsible for your happiness except yourself. Remember that we have no control over what happens to us, only what we do. This is really a neat thing. Now, Bernie usually digs up some cool stuff. Learn something new every day. What others think of us is not completely under our control. Appreciate your body and its marvels. Whoever did this photography, this is pretty exotic stuff. Reject everything that is not useful, amusing, or beautiful. Don't lose time. We already have all the things we need. And there's my mantra, the best is yet to come. This is a pretty neat thing. Of all the things Bernie sends, and he does send some oddball stuff, I have to admit, this is one I found very entertaining. And Bernie, as always, thank you. Look at that face. I'd like to have to fix those feathers in the morning before you wake up. Oh, puffin. Very, very nice, whoever put this together. Enjoy the voyage. There is only one chance to be successful. Please send this message to all friends that you appreciate. Life is beautiful. You must appreciate it as much as possible.
Have a wonderful journey, my dear friend. Bernie, that is pretty special. I think that's really special.
Very, very cool.
I had to show this to Karen. I thought this was so good. That really is good. Wait till you see how nice some of it is. Very cool. Read the sayings. Each one has a little saying. Now, don't you think that's pretty good photography?
It's fabulous.
Need a seahorse. Look at that bird. Pretty cool, huh, baby?
Beautiful.
That Bernie Trent is okay, even if he doesn't do his share at Brodex. Well, it's cold today again. I was hoping I'd get some silver paint, but not sure if it's going to warm up today. They're predicting it's going to stay below freezing all day. I know, guys, it's cold out there. I need it to warm up so I can spray my silver, but it doesn't look like it's warming up as quick as I thought it would. Oh, how these guys make it. They start off a day. Karen and I start off the day really in a good mood. But I think we got from Bernie Trent the other day. Karen really liked it too. Now the other thing, the landscapers were supposed to start today, but because it's like 15 degrees out there, I'm not sure they're even going to show up. But here's the other thing, and this is one of the things going to change. These bushes are going to go, these holly bushes, and that's where the birds kind of hang out during the winter. So we might lose some of our birds. Karen's a little bit, we're both concerned about it a little bit. Look at the thickness of the ice from this lousy winter. Man, I got to chop this 3 or 4 times a day to keep that hole open. What a mess. Well, it doesn't look like the landscapers will be coming in this really cold day, but it's warmed up enough that we can paint, that's for sure. Now, the real trick today, this is highly decanted silver. We've cut the pressure back, and we want to get the thinnest coat possible on here. But even so, I do want to get the edges, and I want to look carefully for dry spots. Any dry spot, I'll pay the price and just put a little more over it. There's a dry spot right there. Now I would always do the small parts first, try to candle them in the sun. One thing in our favor, no wind at all so far. But as soon as I bring the wing out, you can bet. Help me. And even though it's colder than I'd like it to be, the fact that we have no wind today and that we've got a sun that I can reflect and see, I can see my dry spots a little bit better. The only thing is, it's cold, baby. Green Bay Packers stunned here. Now, because we know we're not going to sand on this coat, we really want to get this on nice and smooth. Even though I wiped it, I've got a piece on it. Work I hope is paying off, because what I'm going to do is go back once these parts are painted, just recheck the weight, see that we haven't gained much or any. Maybe we've even lost. Who knows? Because you never know. You can always sand more off than you put on. But we're in the ballpark here. That's what matters. And then I'll be ready to tomorrow to start the white.
Oh, it's a thing of beauty, that last coat. I don't know if other people appreciate it, but I really do. Just feel the first hint of wind coming up now. I knew it just before I'd get that wind out. That's what I was afraid of. If I waited later in the day, it wouldn't warm up that much. And the wind would start blowing, which has been the case most of the times. Always extra on a leading edge. For sure, for sure. That leading edge is always vulnerable. So this was by far the worst piece of the lot. Has the most repairs on it. May need one more coat, I'm not sure. If it does, we'll just let this dry and give it another coat. Again, we did have a lot of repairs, a lot of touch-ups. A lot of edges and angles and hinge pockets and everything here. And these edges are for sure going to take a beating. Now I hear a diesel truck in front of the house. I wonder if that's our landscapers unloading equipment.
There's a big truck getting unloaded there, as I'm thinking.
Maybe these guys are tougher than I think they are. As soon as I'm done painting, I'll run over there and see. Yeah, it's a big backhoe, that's for sure. I assume they're going to start digging. Maybe they dig even when it's cold like this. Who the hell knows?
I don't know if that's the equipment for us or not. I'm going to finish painting here. Because what's going to happen if they're going to start working? I got to remove the curtain. I got to move this furniture. Oh man, that's going to be, well, maybe I get, it's good that I started early here. Maybe I beat the system a little bit.
Yep, the guy's got, that's our machine. It's coming in the yard and they're on a turnpike coming down here. So this really worked out well and I got started early. Famous last words. Oh my God. I can't believe they're going to dig out here today, but I guess they will. That's what I like about being an indoor contractor. Oh! Okay. So I guess we're going to have the start of the job today. Lucky me. And I'm going to have to work out here the first day with them because I notice things have to be moved and there's water lines and gas lines and electric wire going out to the pond and a lot of stuff. One of the things worked out pretty decently is this jig so far, anyway. Well, we're all done, of course. We can still carve it up and make some kind of block out of it. Richard Oliver, eat your heart out, baby. You have no idea what we're going through up here. Well, he's out there flying and fine-tuning his plane. Hey, a little bit of sun's coming out. Well, he's got the machine somewhere here. We got a couple of dry spots here. I was a little concerned about maybe having to give him a second coat. I know there's a spot up there. Ah, here comes our machine. Noise you hear is the machine.
That's okay right there.
Okay, good.
All right, no problem.
Thank you. The idea is to try to get this whole coat done with 1 4-ounce amount of silver, and I know I've sanded more than that off, so I know I'm not going to run the risk of adding a lot of weight. And actually, even if this coat were a little bit dry in spots, the black will cover that up in a heartbeat. And I know our yellow will have a lot of extra pigment in it, so it should be in pretty good shape.
I still can't believe they're going to start this digging job today. Now, as you can imagine, there's still a couple of dry spots on this, and I wanted to get at them. Actually, there's only one. And this is the key with this highly decanted paint, is just constantly shaking it between spray and pour.
And we know we still have some little repair dry type of dry spots here. Thank you. idea here is to get this thin and as smooth as possible. And get it on in less than the amount of this gun. And if we can do that, I'll be impressed. But granted, it's not that easy. You gotta really stretch it out. And I'm always trying to get extra on these spots that are either dry or, of course, it doesn't matter how much we put on the outboard tip. Totally irrelevant. I know these shorts are still an issue.
Told me. Oh, is that ready?
If we would just paint white instead of putting this coat of silver on, we would put 3-4 times the amount of white on to get a nice smooth coverage. And then those stripe outlines would look, either they wouldn't look white, which is what I want, or in some way we'd be compromising it. But my hands are just absolutely frozen out here. I can't believe it. Maybe it's colder than I thought it was, Abby. But I know I gotta move a lot of stuff out here, so knowing this is down by the heating vent drying, my efficiency rating will go up today. Looks like I made it. There's still a little bit of paint in there. Oh, here comes some more heavy equipment. Boy, what timing, huh? The bulldozer just pulls up. Huh? What kind of timing is that? Wow. Can't believe it. Yeah. Jose and his crew are here, ready to work. Looks like we're going to have two backhoes here. Yo! I'm in the back.
Yeah.
A nice warm day like today, you guys are here.
From fruition.
Come on. I got to work out here all day. You see how tough this is. I got to move that furniture, and I'll pull that pond cover off as soon as I'm done painting. I want this paint to dry downstairs.
All right.
There's a bathroom downstairs, if you have to go to the bathroom, and I'll make coffee in about a half an hour.
All right. Thank
okay?
You,
I know. I don't even have to ask, do I? Okay, guys. I'll get them addicted to Gervalia. They won't be able to drink Maxwell House anymore. Okay. A couple of dry spots here. I'm going to get my stuff downstairs. All that work on a Phillips looks like it paid off. Maybe this piece has a spot that may need to do some touch-up on this, but we basically can get ready to get the contracting work underway. I wanted to show this. This is the amount that last coat of silver went on, and I don't know if you can see this, still, well, maybe 1 ounce still in there. So we used about 3 ounces. That's how thin that last coat is. Boy, am I glad that's done. Oh, man. Oh, my day really is complete now. But the stuff I have to do outside, I gotta move some stuff and this is all drying while I'm busy. So we'll make it easy. And everything is sitting up by the heating vent. That's a good feeling on a day this cold. Now what happened is I'm making up a whole set of these I-Beam Spitfire DVDs for one of our friends who's, well, maybe really liking the I-Beam Spitfire, Ed Southworth. And as we're spraying silver, and the copy I'm making for him, Mike is spraying silver too.
No, we got to get outside. We can't. I'd love to sit in here and watch windy DVDs, but I got to get out into the polar bear country.
Just look at, there goes my holly bushes. The first things going bye-bye is the holly bushes. They got two of these machines here now. Amazing. You see some amazing work here in the next couple days. I've seen the work at Pete and Mary Ann's that this crew has done, and the reason we hired them, they weren't the cheapest, but they really do know their stuff. And their work is absolutely artwork. And they do ponds too, so they know all about ponds.
There goes my hedges. Now I look back at the video and when Karen and I planted those little hedges, oh my God, they're higher than I am now. Okay, so they got a crew. I think there's 9 guys all together in this crew. Look at this, how quick stuff gets done when you have a crew. It's amazing. And it is really cold out here, believe me. Even that painting was cold. This is amazing. This machine, it gets in and it pops a stone. They've already had one go in a pond. We've started off 2009 with some cold weather and a lot of action, and look at the thing slipping in the ice. Wow. There's some horsepower there. That's Rojet power.
It's time for lunch. Baby, it's cold out there. It's brutal. These guys are really working. I am really impressed. And I knew they would be. This crew that we hired, we've seen their work, and they are absolutely top shelf. When you see this job when it's done, you'll be very impressed. And I think everything's drying up just beautifully. There's a couple of touch-up spots, but I'm going to let it dry for a while. I don't want to go sand and wet paint. In fact, I'm going to let it go till tomorrow because it's just too good now to risk doing anything crazy.
And those guys are drinking coffee like it's water out there. And believe me, I'm drinking coffee too. We're on our third pot of coffee today.
John Pothier just sent us our keystone. And it doesn't look like we're going to need. See, we originally thought we were going to need black and white backgrounds. The way he laid this out, I am really impressed. I think that's just absolutely perfect. You like that, Kara?
I love it. Beautiful.
All right. I think that's super. And then we're going to get all different size decals made so we can even do these for prop handles and prop little logos and handles and everything. And, of course, the tail of the plane.
So here I am sitting by a quartz heater. My feet are so cold I can't believe it, being outside. We got our little the logo from John Pothier. Oh my God, is this turning out to be a crazy day. I have no idea where this is going.
But on days like today, where you really, I'm getting crazy from the beeping from that backhoe going back and forth. The thing that always gets me through a day like this, I close my eyes and picture we're all at Brodax. It's 80 degrees and everybody's launching planes and eating hot dogs and the women are having a good time and it's what gets me through a day like today. It's amazing.
Look at where this is going in the next 2 hours. Whoa, man. They've got all the slates up. Working on getting the bricks up. Incredible job. And while they're busy out there grinding away, we're waiting for our paint to harden up so we can start doing the touch-ups. And
Of all the things, that little piece on the tail, I've touched that up 4 or 5 times. It's still a nuisance. I'm not sure I'm going to be able to finish it today. I wanted to let it dry thoroughly, but I didn't want to leave it either where it didn't need touch-up. It's sitting right under the heat. You would think it would dry quicker. You can see that little spot that, and I'm not sure I'm making myself crazy for nothing, but a little dry spot there. And then there was a little dry spot down here. Now I just touched that with some 1000 grit. There's the two little spots of all the things on the whole plane. Those are the only two that looks like I'm going to have to maybe take a break when those guys take lunch and run out there. It's going to be really uncomfortable. I don't even have anything I can stage the camera on. I'm down to the mud.
I bet you can tell nothing stops us from getting this paint done. We never accept defeat. We never accept anything. Yeah, it's coming out. It's been a struggle. This little piece has been the worst piece of the whole plane to get right.
Well, I can't wait to get this over with. It's those spots up on the nose. They're just a little bit dry.
I'm getting too fussy about this, but there were just a couple little dry spots up around the nose. Let's see how that looks when it's dry.
Is that my hot soup?
Not
make it boil. Look at this. I wonder why my birds aren't at the feeder today. Holy mackerel, they're digging up my garden, oh, my garage, everything. Oh my God, look at this. Look at this. That's my yard. This morning I had shrubs. I changed my mind, put it back. Oh man, look at this.
Okay, you can come this way, wait.
They've been introduced to Javalia. Look at this. Javalia coffee. Oh boy, that Wendy's a cool guy. Oh, these poor birds, they're so happy. Oh my God, the guy, they stopped using that caterpillar thing in Wendy's driveway. Oh my God, now we can eat. Let's eat, boys. Oh my God, let's eat. Let's quit. Don't show me your tush. Come on, I want you to eat. Because these guys are gonna come back with that big backhoe and oh my God, it's so much fun being in Wendy's feeder today. Wendy, keep that feeder filled. We're freezing out here. The birds, every time Godzilla, the caterpillar, goes back and forth, all my birds disappear. Not one bird at the feeder. Look at this. The bird killer. Karen's checking out the progress. What does it look like out there? Beirut?
Beirut, yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah, it is a disaster up there. It will be for months.
This is what you do when you go to prison, you know. You guys ever been in prison?
I've been.
Oh, yeah. This is what you do right here, prison. Look at my driveway, holy mackerel. Holy caramba. Amazing. Yeah, that's prison. That's unreal. Well, they're going to be back tomorrow. The plan is to come back tomorrow with the full crew and do the same thing over and over again. Until it's gone. These guys put in a day's work. They're even working after dark out there. Beirooting it up is our new saying. Look at this. I have to give these guys credit. They are workaholics. They are out windy and windy here. What a crew. Day one comes to an end. Now this morning we gotta open the door before the guys even get here. Unbelievable.
That's my backyard. Can you believe this? Look at this. All of this work.
Boy, these guys were amazing yesterday. I guess their water froze solid. That's their water. And they drank a lot of coffee, too. Wow. Look at this action. See how the ice is on my pond. Oh. Oh, it was cold last night. That's the winter we have, boy. Oh, man. They got saws, they're cutting things. Holy mackerel. That's amazing. I wanted to record this before they get here in case they come in with a dumpster today. Oh. I guess we're gonna start seeing this thing in action pretty soon. But I know summer's coming, and we're gonna have one. Think of how big this patio is gonna be. This is gonna be an enormous patio. Wow. The stairs gotta go yet. All that's gotta come off today. And our driveway will be wide. We can bring real cars in at the real width. Amazing, that's all I got to say. Amazing. Just unbelievable. Look at how they pull the edge of the building blocks up. Whoa, and there's my newspaper. Oh, lucky me. Oh, I gotta go have Gevalia coffee. This is too much work getting up in the morning. My poor neighbors, their place is all landscaped nice, and look what happens here. Oh, holy mackerel, Andy, look at this go. Well, that whole side of the wall's got to be cleared off. But I'm telling you something, when you see the quality of the work these guys have done, and when I've seen, look at this, they're going to pull this up. I know the porch is going to go. I guess we may as well take this. We're not using this anymore. That's gone. Time to have Gevalia. As we do our walkthrough in the morning. Now, I have two goals here today, just to double check. It looks like all of the work we did on these parts has resulted in that they're right. It gained 1 gram in this coat of silver. So I'm not even gonna even think that that's a problem. And I got all the little spots that I wanted to touch up taken care of, that's done. So the next step on this is now, by looking at my concept drawings, I want to carefully lay out where I'm going to be putting the white, and I need to decant up a pint of white, and that's the next step on this. Now I made this up the other day, and pretty much where I need to put the white so I can check each part and make sure I'm not, as an example, if that stripe goes under the wing, I want to make sure I do that little piece on the fuselage too. So now what I want to do is I want to make sure I take a can of Insignia White out of my stash, because what I want this to be, I have not shaken this up in a long time, maybe over a year, I don't know. This looks like one of the older ones. What I want to do now, I want to very carefully, just as I did with the silver, decant this. And that's a critical step in this. Now the trick, of course, is to try to buy the paint at least a year ahead of time. Let it sit on a shelf undisturbed. Don't run off and just shake it up, or don't, as I tell some people, don't try to use up paint that's a year old, if possible. Even though it's not critical, I'd just rather stack the deck in my favor. Now when I take the lid off of this, what's going to happen is the top, at least half of it, is going to be relatively thin, and all the pigment's going to be at the bottom. This one's really been sitting there a long time. It's very watery at the top. So let me get a clean jar and take off the top half.
Now, what used to happen, and Rich didn't get any this year, but he used to, in the beginning of the fall, start saving kimchi jars. And kimchi is a Korean food that has, I think, a lot of onions or whatever in it. And I would get these nice, big, wide-mouth jars. We called them kimchi jars. What would happen, though, Rich would clean them out and scour them out. We'd let them dry out. But then you'd sniff it, and it smells like onions or something. Well, kimchi. Or fish or whatever the hell is in kimchi. But what was funny is we'd mix up clear dope or something in the jar. And as you're spraying it, you could still smell that kimchi. I'm telling you, it was really funny. Now, I don't know what was in this one, apple butter. There's a very nice smell still coming out of this jar. Anyway, I want to pour off roughly half. I don't really need that much white here, so it's not a big deal. There we go. And when you don't decant paint, and I'll mark that's thin white, because what'll happen is I don't want to use this for anything that I need. I really need coverage. I don't want to have to put 9 coats of white on to get it to cover. I can put a little bit more in it. It's a little less than half. I never want to go more than half, even though I have. And of course, the test is when you spray it that it doesn't come out dry, or the look of that it's a matte finish. If it does, it means you've overdone it. But 50-50 is a safe blend. And this is, and I'll mark this up before I go any further, because what happens, in my own special way, I forget everything. Now, there are plenty of projects in the shop that this will be fine for. It won't matter if I put an extra coat on some things. We're painting props or doing something else. But for right now, this is the liquid gold that we're looking for. This is what we really want to have. This is going to be the decanted white. I'll mark this one up. And I always want to put on the date. Because I never really use all the material. There's always going to be some left. I don't think I'll use this whole can. In fact, if I do, we're going to be in trouble. Now, the other thing is, and this is, I call it the little things that all add up at the very end. I want to take that 4-ounce gun that I have, which puts on the thinnest coat. That's the gun that puts on the thinnest. It's not an airbrush, and it's not an 8-ounce gun. It's a 4-ounce gun, and it has a very fine adjustment. The problem with that gun is it can tend to spray such a thin amount that you don't get a good chemical bond. So I always have to, I call it for Drewski eyes, I have to play with the mix a little bit, paint a few light bulbs or something, and then let it dry. Well, once I mix this, I'm going to paint a test part. I'll clean the silver out of the gun, paint up a test part, and let it dry. If it dries flat white, I need to put a little more clear in the mix. And by the way, just adding clear means you're taking the pigment out, because this is clear dope with pigment. There's no such thing as white dope or black dope. There's clear dope with pigment. So getting that blend just right before I go and paint a model part, very important. Then what I'll do when I actually paint the model part is I'll paint the little insignificant parts like the tip weight box and check them just to make sure I'm not painting myself into a corner. Now, all of these little tips, they all add up, because in the end, once the model's finished and buffed out and you have 2 ounces too much paint on and that extra 4 ounces of nose weight, it's 6 ounces, and now the model's way too heavy. So every step of this finishing thing, it seems like, oh, what a lot of work. Oh, what a pain in the neck. And in the end, you've got it. McCarran just came down and said, oh, the guys are arriving here. The trailer trucks are pulling up in the yard. So I'm not sure we're gonna get anything done here. Are they still here? Okay. I wanted to show this. Here's a mistake I've made in the past. I have one of my star sticks, and I had this much red on the end of it. And without thinking, I said, ah, that's the last of the star sticks. I went and mixed the paint, and within 30 seconds, I had a can of pink paint. Anyway, I wanna get, oh. I always start with 50-50 and then add just enough thinner I wanted to show this, and if you're painting a plane white, this is a must. There's no way you can avoid doing this, unless you want to add about 4 extra ounces for nothing. Oh yeah, I can feel there's a lot of pigment down at the bottom there. And so I think for the whole, well, for the next month or so, these guys are going to be pounding out there. It sounds like bombs are going off. But I'm going to try to, my goal is somewhere in during this day is get this white painted if I can slither out there in between bulldozers backing up and stuff. Now what's really cool is these guys, they told us yesterday when they left, they said we'll be here around 10. It's 9 o'clock. They are really looking to get this job done. This must be a really terrible economy. I'm sure it's a terrible economy, but I am very impressed with how hard these guys work. They are very, very aggressive. All right, we're ready to do a test. We can do a test out there, even if we go paint one of their bulldozers. Ready to go.
Boy, you hear that noise out there? Anyway, that's the first coat of white. It looks, I'm going to let it dry up. I did a little test piece, and of course the tip weight box. Who cares if that has 100 coats of paint on it? Now I'm going to say, and it's impossible to go out there. I got to do it kind of on the stairs. But I wanted to, because the stripe looks like it's going to go right through here, so I may as well, in this case, just paint the whole thing. And it looks like we got the mix pretty close to being what it should be here. And I think that's pretty much where the trim is going to wind up going, but I've given myself plenty of options in case I want to bend the stripe a little bit differently. I've had to stop painting while they're unloading the dumpster. They're digging up so much stuff that dust is getting where I can't even paint. So I guess we'll take a little coffee break here while they unload another the dumpster.
There goes my backyard, going bye-bye in a dumpster.
What are we having tonight? What is that, chicken fajitas?
No, carnitas.
Carnitas.
Oh. It's disgusting.
This guy is sneaking by, scaring all my birds with this dumpster. Oh, my gosh.
It's disgusting.
Oh, what's disgusting? Look at what they're doing in my garage. There goes my motorcycle. Watch this. I wonder if I should move the motorcycle. Here comes in a, well, there's no place to move it. They got me blocked in here with concrete and stuff. I can't even paint while this guy's doing this. I gotta wait till I kinda at a break point.
Well, you know what, after I get everything on the stove, another half hour, then I'm gonna give them this stuff.
There goes the rebar. Oh, no. Hard to believe. All this just trying to get something painted today, but I guess I'll just have to wait. We got two of these guys here. Look at this. There goes my house. Bye bye. Crunch-o-matic. Pretty exciting stuff going on here. Not sure I should keep my car there. Maybe I'll move the car. For some reason, I feel better with my car 2 blocks away.
Yeah, leave me back here. These guys are pretty rough on equipment. Oh my God, my poor house.
So I guess our painting is on hold until we can, until Beirut. Look at these guys, it's unbelievable. They really have, they're gonna fill that dumpster up.
Sure.
You imagine all this stuff. Now, if you look at every one of those bricks, I'm gonna have to go back into the videos and see the day George and I and Craig and we brought those bricks from where the town my sister lives in. We actually got all those bricks for free. How many years have we had that patio?
Craig was 18, so...
He's 31 now?
15 years. He's
33. Wow. The circle of bricks, the circle of life. It's a lot easier moving them with that caterpillar than it was when Craig and I moved them by hand, that's for sure. So the plan is, we're gonna wait to do the big parts until we can get them on a coffee break or something. There's just so much dirt flying around out there. I'm just afraid to go out there. Now I always say that life is an adventure, and if you know where you're going, not much of an adventure. And boy, this yard job is starting to be a real adventure.
But in my life and Karen's life, it seems like everything's an adventure. It just seems like no matter what you plan or how you plan it, it turns out to be an adventure. And I suspect that everybody's life is ultimately an adventure, whether you like it or not. And even having Chickie for those 5.5 years, our companionship and friendship we had with Chickie, even that was part of the great adventure of life. And I would say we're done with Silver, and we've finalized our concept, and we're gonna have that done before the day's over. Even if I gotta work after these guys leave, I wanna get that white on today. Now, I had to sneak out there while they were on their coffee break and shoot this white. Otherwise, I would have never gotten it done. And it's getting colder out there by the minute, as if, I'm not sure it's not that real cold now, but we got the white on. Now, that's going to be the base of all our striping. That the only reason that white is on there is for the striping. And, of course, that's going to dry overnight, so that's probably all the work we're going to get done on a plane today. But even that, and if you think life isn't an adventure, boy, when you think of how this winter's played out, how every plane, and I count this, every plane I've built has some adventure attached to it, something that's just indescribable. And as I walk all around me, I mean, there's no place, I'm surrounded by adventures.
Now, Mike Estella sent this to me. He knows I'm, that Karen wants to buy a Prius. $430,000, I don't think so. Mike Estella, of course, is a big car fanatic and loves his Audis, among other things, but I'm not sure this would be one of mine. In fact, I like my Ford Escort a lot better. See, Rojet powered, 620 horsepower, 0 to 1,000 miles an hour in 3.5 minutes. Who cares about this? Can you get a plane in the trunk? Oh yeah, this is a little more like it. You just put the roof down, plane will fit right in there. And a lot cheaper, 10,000 cheaper, 20,000 cheaper. Wow, they're really dropping in price here. This one only has a paltry 500 horsepower. Who would want to drive that? Oh, global warming. The poor seals are falling into the water here. You gotta be out in my backyard. Now, you wanna see how cold it is. See what we got here, 600 horsepower. Oh, that'd be great for taking your wife to get her nails done. Okay, now we're cooking with gas. Look at those side scoops. Looks like they stole my side scoops. Look at this. This Koning scoop gaba gaga gaga for 500,000. A paltry 800 horsepower. Who would want to drive that? Where are the Ducatis when you need them? Now you're cooking with gas. Now that's worth the money. A paltry 600,000. Look at that. Look at those scoops. That is pretty nice. A Celine is a nice car. For one, at least that is worth it. Of course, first you gotta have the money. I don't think Karen will approve that check. Somehow I don't think that check's gonna get written out of my bank account. Now there's some side scoops. Oh, let's see what this one is. 600,000. Jeez. And so convenient when it rains, too. God. You know, you ought to do just glue two Ducatis together here if you want to live like this. Maximum speed, horsepower 700. Oh, yeah. That'll get good mileage. Actually, Mike, we really do enjoy these pictures. I'm just making fun of these guys. The rich guys in the world that have all the money. And I'm making fun of them because I'm jealous. Has nothing more than that. And they have bigger side scoops than I do. Wow, that looks cool. Midgley would like that color, I know. This, by the way, just a funny little thing. This color that a lot of cars come in now, this bronze color, Karen goes off the chart crazy when I tell her we're going to get her new Prius in that color. She just goes ballistic. She cannot stand that color. And only 1,046 horsepower. I have to be honest, I'd rather have a Ducati if I was going to spend a lot of money. If I'm going to break out the piggy bank, I think I'd get a Ducati. 600 horsepower. Yeah, this is funny now. Just think of this. The new Ducatis have just under 200 horsepower. I wonder if these things are three times as heavy. Sure, they got to be. A Ducati's 340 pounds, 360, 18, 2,000. Yeah, it's probably close. Now you're in Karen's price range. Seven figures. Horsepower, 1,000. Now, maybe this is faster than a Ducati. I ought to bite my tongue here. I don't know. Anyway, from Mike Estella, hey, we really like that. Believe me. It makes my day, especially while they're out there jackhammering my house. By the way, I had to go out and move the motorcycle and cover it. Stones were flying up into it as they were jackhammering out there. It's pretty exciting what they're doing in my house. Especially because I don't know when it's going to end. Now, before I pack it in here, Bernie Trent sent some pictures of some, what he calls castles, unusual castles. Well, you know what? I don't know how... It's pretty unusual, I guess, but I gotta admit, I like Richard Oliver's house better. So, you know, that makes sense. You can get a flying field right out in front. I think that's perfect. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. You know, you wonder if these are 018 cables or what, or if this tree has any roots at all. Probably the thing's 100 years old. It's all dry rotted. That's definitely good. Yeah, I guess whatever turns you on, million-dollar cars with 9,000 horsepower or living on the top of a mountain, I don't know. I think Richard Oliver's the one's got it right here. I'm not sure, Bernie. Bernie, I don't know where you find these things, but we do enjoy seeing them every day to lighten our load. Now, to be honest, I made a lot of tree houses when I was a kid. I don't think this would be exactly what I had when I was a kid. At the place we just sold. This is good. You can drill for oil when you got nothing to do while you're waiting for your Gervalia coffee in the morning. And this would be good if you knocked down a lighthouse and put in a flying field. I guess the wind would never stop blowing, though. Look at this. They even have Al Gore's home. I wonder if he lives in this house or this house. You know, this is going to melt soon. Boink. Anyway, interesting stuff from our good friend Bernie Trent. Now, my son-in-law and I, we've been trying to team up with a friend of ours, the guy that went to the motorcycle show with us, because he's a gun expert. And we've been thinking about getting some target guns, 22s, just to shoot some target practice, just for a nice hangout kind of thing, because I don't play golf and he doesn't fly model planes. So we've been interested in guns lately. And you got to see this to believe it.
And I told her not to mess with it. And as you can see, she's not the best. Following directions, so just like she always does to me, tries to make fun of me, so now I'm gonna give revenge in the way any husband should. Good old leftover 4th of July.
You gotta see this to believe it. I almost died when I saw this. I can picture Karen with the gun. Just picture Karen, this would be funny. Yeah, check that gun out, baby. I'll blow that water bottle to kingdom come. Check this out. Who does this remind you of doing this to poor Karen? Watch closely at the wife. Look at this bastard.
Now that is a husband's revenge. Come on, baby.
That is priceless. I can't believe that. That is priceless. So Rob doesn't know when we're going to get these guns, but it's on our list. It's on our bucket list. Our bucket to-do list. Get some target practice guns. Go hang gliding. What else? Already did that. Get a new motorcycle. Yeah, may do that. And get my pavers done. These guys are out there forever. I'm so sick of hearing them banging and the beep, 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 beep.
Wish they had to go out and cut the wire to that beeper.
Well, you guys really caught a break. It's above freezing right now. I can see the water dripping in the back. And when water's dripping, I know it's above freezing. That'll make the rest of the afternoon a piece of cake as they get the last of my driveway up. I gotta go get a drop cloth to cover my motorcycle. It's hope these guys haven't been throwing any stones on it or anything. I have no more birds. My birds have abandoned me in favor of the bull. They're afraid of that bulldozer boy. You think this isn't a big job? You think there isn't tonnage here? Look at what they're taking away. It's unbelievable. Unbelievable job. This is amazing. And when this is done, Karen will have her dream house. Now, John Pothier wanted to know about quality paving job. Check how deep these guys are going. Against my hand, it's way more than a foot that they're going down into this. They pretty much got this part done, and it's not even the end of the second day yet. This is, all the stones are gone. Wow, this is gonna be some backyard. And it is, you can see the stuff dripping. So dripping means we're above freezing for the first time in a couple weeks. My poor motorcycle, you can write your name in the seat and the top of the tank. I went and bought a drop cloth for a proper drop cloth. And I hope the poor motorcycle doesn't get a stone through it or something. So far it's just dirt. The next step is going to be to pull a back porch off this little railing thing, and this has got to go because they got to get underneath that with the block.
Cole, wave to Mr. Ertnowski.
Cole, Mr. Ertnowski to you. Cole, you want to drive that? I bet if you were good, the guy would let you sit on his lap for a couple minutes later. Jose, can you take this kid for a ride later?
He actually offered before, but Cole.
Oh, he did? Okay.
Yeah, he did.
It's part of the job, you know?
He did. He was like, you want to come sit here? But he said no. He was like, no, I'll stay here.
Cole, I bet they could put you in that bucket and give you a ride. Right? Remember when you were helping me load those stones? Go look in front of the house and see where they are. Look at these outlaws have pizza over here. Look at this. Boy, am I jealous. Pizza for lunch. I'm not allowed to have pizza for lunch. I got a peanut butter and jelly.
I like that too. That's good. Can they get out?
Oh, yeah. Oh. Yeah, no, they're eating because, see, when these guys are taking their lunch, they run over and have their lunch. They're scared to death of the dumpster,
oh,
of the caterpillar.
Machines, yeah.
If he parks under there, they don't come to the feeder. Oh, sorry, guys.
That's right. They have mine.
Everybody loves Wendy. Oh, look at this. Oh, my God.
We're babysitting overnight.
Hey, how's your construction job coming?
So far, so good.
We're waiting to be invited over. I hear all that noise over there. She lives in that house right behind there. Is it done yet?
It's pretty. The only thing I've got to paint my hood. Other than that, the backsplash just got to be.
We can see part of it from our back windows. We can see it.
I left Karen a note. I said, please come over. I see you guys are busy.
Oh, we're busy. Another neighbor. Chris, you want to put up some bleacher seats here? You have any lawn chairs or something we can sit on? I want to get a picture of Michael. Where's Michael?
No, you know Molly Jenner? Bob Jenner? Yeah. They're dogs.
You better be cleaning up after those mugs.
No,
where's
my property?
Where's the pooper scoop?
Mike, where's Michael? I want to get a picture of him.
Cutting through.
Aren't
they cute?
Oh, my
you know
God.
Bob Jenner, right? Bob Jenner? Da-da-da.
I know who he is.
Da-da-da. Life with Wendy. Oh, it's heartbreaking just to open this door in the morning. End of day three. It looks like it's getting warmer. Everything's melting. Oh, mud. Now everything's mud. Bricks. Now we got our property quadrant off. Looks like the pond's melting up a little bit. That's always good. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Wow. I'm still shocked when I see how much work this is. Whoa, is this work. He's down almost 12 inches here. Yeah. Man, this is some job. Porch is gonna go probably the next day. Sunday, nobody's working today. We have some social obligations today, so this is not gonna happen. Boy, that is some job. You can't, until you see it in real life, you can't even appreciate it. This is pretty impressive. That used to be my lawn. Oh man. We gotta put a piece of the rug from the garage up here because you can't even walk in and out of the house anymore. In 2 days, I'm just gonna guess, these guys have moved tons, literally tons of material. Pretty impressive. But we got things we gotta do today. We can't even think about this today. And here's our good friend who's running for mayor in the town of Sea Caucus against, this is the mayor now, who's front page of the paper, baby. Not bad. We're gonna go, Karen. You're the treasurer? What are you, the treasurer, Karen?
His campaign,
yeah. Okay, we're going to be spending the day with him trying to, I don't know.
His press conference today.
His press conference is today. We spent Christmas with him. You remember him from his main claim to fame, a star of Windy Videos. Boy, I was totally wrong. Look at his tires slipping in the mud. I was totally wrong. Here it is Sunday. They told us yesterday they might not be back today. But because it's nice and warm, I think they wanted to get another day of digging in. Yeah, they have both of the machines going here. Oh man, look at this. They got wood planks. Oh yeah, a lot of stuff coming down here. They're out here working. I thought they weren't going to work. Well, it's Sunday. We have to go to church. We have to go to Pete Weiner's. I guess they're going to just work while we're gone.
Now, I just know everybody loves to see me in a suit. Notice my great badge. Pete Weiner, 2002. 2009, you believe this? Anyway, I just need to make like a cameo appearance here in clean clothes once in a while. The guys are gone, and it's time to do our political obligations. And back in the shop tomorrow to do some painting. I'm itching to do some painting.
And everything is drying up beautifully. It just couldn't be any nicer. Tomorrow we start backmasking a plane, assuming the bulldozers don't knock my house down.
Jim Southworth sent us this quick little thing, which everybody will identify as something new that they're going to have at Brodex this year. I don't know what you would call this. The glider launch. He said he enjoyed watching us hang glide in Brazil, but this was better. Now this definitely is good. You gotta watch this. Even Midgley will like this. I know he's always up to these things.
All right, have fun.
Have fun. See you at Brodex. Watch this. Now this is one of the reasons I like Control Line better than whatever this is. Yeah, I gotta try that. Now everybody knows that I'm a Ford retiree and getting a Ford pension at this point in my life. And I was glad to see this came from Ford Motor Company today. This is very typical of, I don't want to spoil it. You watch it.
Nice ride you got there, kid.
You guys still gonna take me in?
Not yet.
Bold moves. They happen every day.